Students protest over shortage of accommodation. Baki's proposal to split regional police commands. And progress in the prevention of maternal mortality.
This is National MTV News with Tokana Hasavi.
Good evening and welcome to another working week. Thanks for joining me. Students at the Port Moresby Technical College are facing accommodation problems. A protest was held this morning to demand answers from the Institute's administration. Since last year, the college has been operating on student tuition fees without funding from responsible agencies.
This is what was happening this morning in front of the Port Moresby Technical College administration block. Students gathered to show their frustration. They were demanding answers following the school's administration telling them to double up and share these small cubic rooms. The college has only four dormitories that cater for over 500 students. The shortage of boarding space has forced the college to house students off campus at the IPA College at Waigani and Jubilee University at Rainbow near Gerehu. Due to the Pacific Games, the IPA College has been forced to move students back to Port Moresby Technical to double up with students living in campus. This sparked the protest by students this morning.
Okay, now, just because the strike number,
College principal Alan Tira told MTV News the school was running solely on student tuition fees. Tira says only 100,000 kina was released last year by the Office of Higher Education, and this year nothing has been given. And the notice by PNG IPA to move students out of Waigani will now see a classroom used as a dormitory for the students.
Okay, we'll be preparing plan B, okay? And that is to have the classroom set up, okay? And then we will move everybody in, okay? After this week. Okay, they cannot allow us to use their facilities any longer than 1 week.
The bigger problem for the college now is the dormitory projects that were supposed to be built in 2008. MTV News was told the project was worth over 1 million kina. Today, only the foundations of the buildings have been built.
In the administration of TVET, funds that were allocated for the major project, which includes the girls' dormitory and the boys' dormitory, have never arrived.
The national government now looking this like, especially the Minister for Education, are you going to raise our concern and stand on behalf of the students of Port Moresby Technical College?
Stanley Over Jr., National MTV News.
The ban on Australians visiting the autonomous region of Bougainville has been lifted today. The Minister for Foreign Affairs, Rimeng Patel, made the announcement just 17 days after the ban was imposed. Minister Patel said there was a serious lack in communication between the two countries, but following diplomatic talks, they had reached a common ground and could now move forward from the issue. In his statements, Patel strongly reaffirmed PNG's opposition to the establishment of an Australian diplomatic mission on the autonomous region of Bougainville. Police Commissioner Gary Baki will be taking to government a proposal to split the Momase and Highlands Regional Police Commands with the aim to improve efficiency and control. From the Momase region, East Sipik, Sundown and Western provinces will make up what will be known as the Border Regional Command.
Today was Gary Baki's official engagement outside of Port Moresby since taking up office as police commissioner. He came to Ramu with a set purpose, first to reaffirm calls for discipline and to announce that there would be structural changes in the Royal Papua New Guinea Constabulary. Of prime concern have been the reports of poor discipline and the poor image of the constabulary.
Enough is enough.
Today he announced structural changes that would lead to resolving those long-standing command and control issues. They include the splitting of the Highlands and Momase regional commands headed by assistant police commissioners.
Split that. Momase, I've decided to split it into two. So you have Momase that will look after Medeng, Morobe and Lae Metropolitan, and you have the border which takes East and West Sepik. The only difference is I'm putting Western Province in because of the border. So you have that responsibility, overlapping responsibility by the commander.
While there have been changes in the constabulary, the RPNGC has not adapted as quickly enough to population growth. New technology and new policing methods, police-to-citizen ratio remain well below accepted international standards.
And then the Highlands is just too big. One, seven provinces for one commander to sit in Hagen in the hope that he can go as far as Hela is just unacceptable.
The structural improvements fit into the government's overall strategy to build a modern police force. The new commands will mean new infrastructure and additional resources to make the commanders more visible. Scott Waide, National MTV News, Ramu.
Police Minister Robert Atiafa has described the National Police Housing Project as a disgrace. He has since spoken to Commissioner Gary Baki to initiate an investigation to establish how 100 million kina was spent. He said some of the work done on police housing all over the country remain incomplete and are of poor quality.
I can declare that it's a failure. I mean, fail not only the project in Bumbu, but one in Kuapena, the others in Kimeninga in Hagen. Going on in Kainantu and elsewhere. So what I have instructed the commissioner now is to institute an audit on the modernization program and find out as to where all that money has been and how it has been used.
The construction of the new multi-million kina Leicester Police Station is on schedule as part of the Australian Papua New Guinea Policing Partnership Program. Today, the Lae Police Top Command took a tour of the modern operations facility with members of the Australian Federal Police. Both the AFP Assistant Commissioner Alan Scott and Lae Metropolitan Superintendent Ivan Lakatani say the partnership has helped improve some areas of logistics and infrastructure in the Lae Police. MTV's Bethany Harriman has this report.
Sitting in the centre of Lae is the city's new face for the law and justice sector. In its final stages of construction, this will be the 4 million kina Lae Central Police Station. It aims to bring confidence to the city's business houses and residents. The building, due for completion this month, will house a state-of-the-art operations room to help curb Lae's crime problems.
All new chairs, tables, computers, all that's going to be going into this new building.
Today, Metropolitan Superintendent Ivan Lakatani was given a tour of his new office. He was accompanied by members of his senior command, including Alan McClay, Lae's Chamber of Commerce president. The new modern facility is contained in a two-story building that comes from Papua New Guinea's closest friend and ally, Australia, in the Policing Partnership Program. The tour of the facility's construction today came after the presentation of a new vehicle designed to transport prisoners for hearings and medical emergencies.
We have been trying to muddle around with the vehicles that we have to, you know, transport the detainees to the hospitals, to the cells, to the court.
The AFP officers who are working here realised that there was a need for a vehicle to work in the cells area.
This vehicle assistance may seem small, but it comes when the Lae Central Police Station has been struggling with logistics problems. Now in 2013, the Marlborough Provincial Government gave five vehicles. This new vehicle adds to that fleet, While the Leh Central Police Station building, the new one that is, will give the Leh police a bigger, better image. Bethany Harriman, National MTV News, Leh.
The all-search batting team ends their tour of Morobe, also East New Britain cash crops, and NGO group helps to reduce maternal mortality. Those stories coming up after the break. Stay tuned. Good to have you back with National MTV News. The All Search Pacific Games Baton Relay team ended their week-long stay in the Morobe province with a final tour of Leh City. PNG Defence Force personnel led the relay before passing it on to university students and later to the Leh Snacks Tigers rugby league team. The day's tour ended on the ridges of Morobe province.
In their final leg of the relay in the Morobe province, the Baton toured Leh City. PNGDF soldiers had the honour of starting the relay before passing on to UPNG students and correctional services personnel. The wider community and businesses also had their chance to run and touch the baton. Team PNG athlete Debono Paraka joined the relay, running it across the walkway and into the waiting hands of the fire brigade. Preschool kids, primary and high school students all came out in the rain. The baton was later taken to the Sir Ignatius Kilaga Stadium and Leh Snacks Tigers rugby players ran the track before passing to All Search Ambassador Bart Filliman to give a few words of encouragement and support to Team PNG. Then it was on the helicopter and gone. The following morning, just before the baton's flight out of Morobe, the team took a quick helicopter ride to the land of Zenig for a quick relay. Then the boys on the grassy hills of Morobe took the baton on a ride along the ridge. The All Search Baton Relay continues.
Farmers in East New Britain province have been urged to uphold their finest cash crops like cocoa, coconuts and balsa, despite the outset of crop diseases. The Deputy Prime Minister and East New Britain Regional Member, Leo Dion, said East New Britain is being outplayed by other provinces in cash crop farming. He says the province must retain its status as the leader of cash crop production in the country.
The story of cocoa farming and copra in East New Britain province is one that has a very long history. But in the early year 2000, the inception of plant diseases such as the cocoa pod borer has made farmers switch to farm alternative cash crops that has limited markets. This has contributed to a steady decline in the cash crop production levels, and to a larger extent, it affected the provincial economy. In a gathering last week in Karawat, the Deputy Prime Minister, who is also the regional member for East New Britain province, told his countrymen and women that they must not give up despite the challenges they face in cash crop farming.
As a regional member, you may buy down, no look stop. Now there are four provinces, they come, now use him institution, blow you me. Only kiss him, save, kiss him knowledge, now they develop him. Good club, all the developing provinces, blow you me, or blow all. But you me, no good you me, buy him louse, stop, stop. I run it long, coconuts, now let's plus something or same. Now behind.
East New Britain province is renowned for its high-quality cocoa beans and copra, but in recent years, East New Britain is being outplayed by other provinces in terms of cash crop production like cocoa, coconut and balsa. And this noticeable drop in the agriculture output has been an ongoing topic of discussion on how the province will regain these lost commodities.
Cacao grow long supply now leading now. Balsa grow long supply now leading province belong you me. Or save long supply happy kissim kilkilim die all. Now you mean no god now.
Various researches have been carried out by agriculture institutions here in East New Britain with the primary aim of improving agriculture output of the province and most importantly to regain those lost confidence in cash crop farming. Edwin Fidelis, National MTV News, Kokopo.
Maternal mortality in Papua New Guinea has risen dramatically since 1996. But despite this, Marisops PNG, a non-governmental organization, has made great progress in increasing the availability and accessibility of family planning. Statistics have shown that services provided by MSPNG in 2014 have prevented more than 47,000 unwanted pregnancies, reducing the risk of pregnancy-related deaths by 32%.
According to Maristops PNG's 2014 annual report, Papua New Guinea continues to have some of the poorest health outcomes in the Asia-Pacific region. This is particularly in terms of maternal and child health and sexual and reproductive health indicators. Every day, almost 1 million PNG women are at risk of having an unwanted pregnancy, and at least 30 women lost their lives during childbirth.
Maternal mortality is an indicator of disparity and inequity between men and women, and its extent is a sign of women's place in society and their access to social and nutrition services and to economic empowerment.
Since 1996, maternal mortality has been extremely high in PNG, and unfortunately, the situation has not improved. Before the age of 20, 22% of teenagers have had at least one child, and many drop out from high school and marry at a very young age. Multiple unplanned and successive births among young women has significantly increased the risk of pregnancy-related deaths and the risk of their children dying before the age of five. PNG's contraceptive prevalence rate has also remained low, and the interest of individuals or couples in receiving family planning has decreased due to shortage of skilled providers.
Slow decline in fertility. The population remains young, and about 40%, and I repeat, 40% of our population are under 15 years of age. Hence, our youth dependency remains very high.
Last year, Maristops PNG significantly scaled up its operations. With its presence in 11 provinces of PNG, it has prevented 255 deaths, 1,109 unsafe abortions, and 47,562 unwanted pregnancies. They are working closely with the Health Department and the Department of National Planning to improve the health outcomes of PNG. Vasina Tayama, National MTV News.
The Simbu Provincial Education System is providing quality education that will improve school infrastructures. Karawagi Secondary School in Simbu opened one of its finest student dormitories last Friday. The construction of the new male dormitory was an initiative of the school's administration and governing council.
This is the crowd that gathered to witness the opening of a new student dormitory at Karawagi Secondary School in Simbu.
People are present in 30,000 Kinai Golong Karawagi Secondary School.
The Morobe Governor Kelly Naro opened the new building. The new facility built was funded through the school's 2013 tuition fee free funds. Karawagi Secondary School Principal Samuel Connor says completion of the project hinged on cooperation from all stakeholders.
For, I believe, in housing them properly, protecting their interest of the students, their learning, their welfare in school. So once they're emotionally healthy, their mind is focused on learning and then learning technique.
The school, being one of the oldest in the Highlands, has produced some of the country's elites. Over 100 male students will use the dorm. The secondary school dormitory will compare to a university dormitory.
The governing council and the principal and staff, they are taking the lead now. They are setting the new precedence in setting up state-of-the-art dormitories.
Karawagi Secondary School has set the precedence for other schools around the country to use government funds to build better infrastructure. Colleen Barilai, National MTV News.
And now we take a look at the finance news. The Kina closed unchanged at 0.3675 US dollars in the interbank market. At Bank South Pacific, our Kina was trading at 0.36 US dollars, 0.4681 Australian dollars, 0.3242 euro, and 42.26 Japanese yen. Looking at commodity prices at New York close, gold and coffee closed the day higher, while copper and cocoa closed lower. Palm oil and copper also closed the day lower, while crude oil closed the day higher. And lastly, on the stock market, the Dow Jones closed at 152 points lower, the ASX closed a point lower, and the All Ordinaries closed unchanged. Well, National MTV News continues after this break. Stay with us. Good to have you back with the news. The Technical Vocational Education Training Scholarship Scheme, initiated by the National Capital District Commission, is helping NCD youths to find employment. Over 1,600 successful applicants were given their tuition fees under the TVET program to continue studies in the various partner institutions. Over 1 million kina was presented to these institutions by NCD Governor Paul Parker today as the Commission's investment in building human resources.
This human resource building program involves almost all technical and vocational institutions in Port Moresby, like Don Bosco Technical Secondary Institute, Ohola Vocational Center, and Port Moresby Business College. This program was initiated to create a sustainable foundation for youths here in the nation's capital. Since its inception in 2008, over 9,000 students were financially supported to pursue their education in either technical or vocational centers. Over 9 million kina was used so far in this program.
This program has come in partnership with all the vocational and technical institutes to try to give you all our young people who cannot make it to secondary school another chance to have a strong foundation for the future.
Peter Gary is a successful TVET recipient. The scheme has lifted his financial burden and given him the opportunity to study human resource management at the International Training Institute. He is an example of many others who have studied under this scholarship. Some are already in the workforce.
TVET scholarship program scheme has introduced some of the parents and parents of our parents.
Governor Parkop, when presenting the checks to the schools, highlighted the responsibilities that come with the scheme. Parkop said out of the 2,000 applicants, only 1,653 students were successful this year and challenged them to use the opportunity to better their lives. The program is aimed at minimizing financial challenges most youths face and is a step towards reducing the high unemployment rate amongst youths. Tekla Gunga, National MTV News.
The rate of employment opportunities in the government sector has remained almost the same in the last decade. Despite hundreds of school leavers graduating annually, many do not find employment in the government sector. This was highlighted by NCD Governor Powis Parkup when addressing technical and vocational students here in Port Moresby this morning.
The high unemployment rate in Papua New Guinea has become a growing concern in recent years. Each year, more people migrate to urban areas in search of a job, but many end up placing a financial constraint on the families they migrate to live with. This concern remains one of government's main challenges, particularly in the provincial capitals.
At the same time, population is increasing, but the job market or the economy is not increasing at the same time.
Despite numerous programs created to address the unemployment statistics, the reality is not many Papua New Guineans venture into established businesses that can create job employments for fellow citizens. But while there are limited job offers in the public sector, Governor Parkop said job opportunities lie in the private sector. He said because the government only provides limited job opportunities, people must take up the challenge to create jobs in the private sector.
We must have a good environment by which the people who have money, they will invest, they will start business. And when their business is growing well, then they will give you jobs.
Parkop said there is a need for Papua New Guineans to professionally organize their businesses to meet the country's average population growth of 3%. Currently, most Papua New Guineans are employed by foreign-owned businesses. PAKOP wants to see more nationally-owned businesses established so long-term sustainable income benefits are created for nationals. Takla Gunga, National MTV News.
Maritime Security Division under the PNG Transport Department will provide the Solomon Islands with international ship and port facility security technical assistance. Senior officers from the Solomon Islands Port Authority are in Port Moresby undergoing a capacity building program. The program is beneficial for trade to enhance the level of maritime safety in Papua New Guinea and the Solomon Islands.
Benny Legua, Director Corporate Services, and Nelson Kikoni, Port Facility Security Officer from Solomon Islands, are here to undergo a two-week program. The program is in regard to the implementation of the Maritime Security Code, or International Ship and Port Facility Security, or ISPS, across the Pacific Island region. The officers will be coached in the areas of carrying out port facility security assessments, development of port facility security plans, audit of port facilities, and ships that engage in international trade. They will also conduct security drills and exercises and develop standard operating procedures to enforce the ISPS code in the port facilities.
Stringent requirements for the last 10 years of call for ship sailing internationally would be detrimental for ship sailing to or from port facilities that fail to comply with the ISPS security measures. As such, it is equally important for PNG, as Solomon Islands cargoes are transshipped for lay to Solomons, and ships from Honiara to Noro in the Solomon Islands are called into a court of lay.
All ports must comply with the mandatory international security requirements and measures, especially for maritime purposes, or it will affect trade. Since PNG trades with Solomon Islands through the ports of Lae and Noro in SI, the Transport Department agreed to help SI, who's currently one of the non-compliant ports in the world.
On behalf of my government, I must also add that PNG is really living up to its nickname, the Big Brother in the MSG block, in taking the lead to initiate this opportunity and allowing for our nationals to further develop their skills, confidence, capacity, and to shape up their know-how in their respective fields in this program.
The technical assistance program is conducted for Solomon Islands to identify what areas need improvements to be port compliant and to allow international trade to flow smoothly. Vasina Tayama, National MTV News.
Opposition leader Don Polier says that the Kumu flyover here in Port Moresby is a big waste of taxpayers' money. Money that could be used to save many lives in the rural areas of the country. Mr. Polier held a news conference this afternoon to express his views.
Is PNG modernized was the opposition question when commenting on the cost variation of building the Kumul Flyover Bridge in Port Moresby. A disappointed opposition leader Don Polier said the cost of structure should have been lower than 120 million kina.
But when over 162 270 million in variation. That's not modernizing Papua New Guinea, that's corrupting Papua New Guinea. That does not modernize PNG because that's so much money, an extra 100 million to 150 million kina that could have been spent in building a similar flyover in place like the Ramu Highway. Looking at the roads that are collapsing, like recently I've been to the East Shipping and I saw the Shipping Highways there.
Mr. Polier said that the national government should not preach to the whole world that Papua New Guinea is modernized when the per capita income is low.
We would like to call on Papua New Guineans to see what is happening. That the real modernization of PNG will be achieved when you see the local person in the village, the rural Papua New Guinean, will see an improvement to per capita income, an increase to the per capita income, and the sustainability of the per capita income. Those very important areas are yet to be achieved. They need to improve the per capita income of our Papua New Guineans. And that you don't measure that by assessing the citizens living in Port Moresby. You never. The opposition's principle is we do not measure modernization by looking at the people who are living in Port Moresby or Lae. We measure the modernization by measuring the per capita income of Papua New Guineans living out there in the most outback societies, like Teleforming, like Kande.
With Prime Minister Peter O'Neill speaking at the official opening of the Kumul Flyover Bridge yesterday, said it's an investment to change the face of the capital city.
We must work together for the future. The future is our children. What sort of society are we going to leave behind for them? This flyover is the first of many to come. There will be many later on, but this is certainly the first one.
Mr. Poli said that so much money has been concentrated mainly on infrastructure and not basic needs like health. Fabian Hakalitz, National MTV News.
Well, we've got True Guy Sports, that's coming up next, and another Toa to compete at the Oceania Weightlifting Championships. Details after these short messages. Stay with us.
True Guy Sports.
Welcome to True Guy Sports. The president of PNG Weightlifting Federation, Sir John Dawaninkura, today announced PNG's weightlifters who will participate in the Oceania Weightlifting Championships in July. The team of lifters will include senior, youth and junior weightlifters who will compete in their divisions respectively.
These lifters will take center stage at the coming Oceania Championships from July the 5th to 9th, with most of them to compete in the youth and junior categories.
July, and the 5th of July is also the date that competition starts at 11 o'clock. So weigh-in will be between 9 a.m. and 10 a.m. and competition starts on the 5th of July.
The senior lifters left the country yesterday to train in Noumea in New Caledonia. They will team up with the younger lifters in July. Among the youth lifters are Konio Tua, the younger sister of top female lifter Dikatoa.
I'll be competing in the 53 kg category with my sister in this Oceania Championship. And hopefully in the youth, I'm ranking first in the youth. And in the junior, I'm not confident with it. But hopefully I'm ranking second or third, maybe.
Konyo will compete in 53 kg category in the youth division, the same one as her sister, Dikatoa.
And all other stakeholders, we have been working towards a vision to achieve medals in the seniors as well as the juniors. So,
other young lifters include SP Junior Athlete Award winner, Bea Ovia, and 18-year-old Gassi Hani, who will participate in the 105kg division. Shane Saroya, National MTV Sports.
To football, and the road to Rio 2016 became clearer for Oceania's eligible member associations today following the release of the match schedule for both the men's and women's Olympic qualifiers. Both men's and women's events will form part of the 15th Pacific Games here in Port Moresby, Papua New Guinea, from the 3rd to the 18th of July, with all matches to be played at Bisini Sports Complex.
In the men's event, 8 teams have been confirmed to take part, 5 of them IOC member associations, Fiji, New Zealand, Papua New Guinea, Solomon Islands and Vanuatu. 3 more non-IOC member associations will also be competing in the Pacific Games branch of the competition, New Caledonia, Tahiti and the Federated States of Micronesia. The 8 countries will be drawn into 2 groups of 4 teams, with the top 2 IOC members from each group set to progress to the semi-finals, and the winner set to contest the final, where the victor will go on to represent the OFC at the 2016 Olympic Games in Rio, Brazil. The format to find the winners of the gold, silver and bronze medals for the Pacific Games will use the same group competition as the OFC Olympic qualifier. But it will be the top 2 Pacific Games Association members from each group who will then qualify for the semifinals. 2015 Pacific Games Women's Football Tournament will double as stage 1 of the OFC Women's Olympic Qualifier, with 7 teams set to participate. IOC member associations Cook Islands, Fiji, Papua New Guinea, Samoa, Solomon Islands and Tonga are all taking part, with the only non-IOC member association participating, that of New Caledonia. In this event, a group of four teams and another of three teams will play a round robin on a league basis. The winner and runner-up of each group qualifying for the semifinals, and the winner contesting the Pacific Games gold medal. The highest-ranked IOC member association will qualify for Stage 2, where a home-and-away playoff against New Zealand in October awaits them. The winner of the playoff on aggregate score will represent the OFC at the Women's Football Tournament in Rio next year. The draw for the OFC Men and Women's Olympic Qualifying Tournament has yet to be announced. Jeremy Mogi, National, MTV Sports.
Well, True Kai Sports continues with snooker and NRL. Details of that on the other side of these messages. Stay tuned.
True Kai Sports.
Good to have you back with True Kai Sports. And in snooker, Gewa John marked a milestone when she beat Demita Bray in the 2015 PNG Women's Snooker Grand Final here in Port Moresby. Since its staging in 2003, Gewa has now been unbeaten in a decade after winning her first women's snooker title back in 2006. With the success of 40 women competing in this year's titles, the recently established Women in Snooker Association is now embarking on staging more women's tournaments in the country.
Gewa John took out the PNG women's snooker titles against Demita Bray in the grand final at Lamanas Q Club in Port Moresby. Gewa set the pace in the first frame with a 48-18 win, and she followed that to take the second frame 65-18. Demita fought back but went on to Gewa 55-41 points in the third frame.
I didn't expect to make it to grand final. I had my hopes up of going as far as I could. And I suppose getting into grand final, I'm very elated and also sort of upset that I didn't put in much time and effort into getting all my drills done to compete against the champion. Yeah.
In the fourth frame, Gewa set her sights clear to take the title 65-17.
I am so happy. I don't even know how to put it in words, but I really did want it to win for the 10th time. Maybe they come back next year and get it off from me. It's all good with me because I'm just so happy I've made it, 10 years in a row.
A record 40 women competed for the titles, with 12 pool players trying their hand in snooker. Madeline Kiner, Helen Samuel and Rucker Holt were among the top 16 quarter-finalists and semi-finalists respectively, which were also awarded during the presentation.
This year we've doubled that. We've gone to 40. And that is a milestone in itself. So congratulations to all the ladies that participated. Well done. Welcome on board all the new ones. And next year you won't be new ones anymore. You'll be old ones. So you're kind of expected there next year. And for all those that back up every year, well done again.
With the establishment of the Women in Snooker Association, more tournaments will be staged to grow and develop the sport of snooker in the country. Skola Sengi, National, MTV Sports.
Well, coming off Origin on Wednesday night, the round 12 of the NRL saw the St. George Illawarra Dragons come away with a massive win over the Cronulla Sharks, 42-6. The end of the round sees the Brisbane Broncos at the top of the table, but that could change if the Melbourne Storm are victorious in their clash against the Sydney Roosters tonight.
Friday night football saw the Eels surprise the Panthers 26-20. In an entertaining match of football, the Eels held off a late fight back from the Panthers to secure the win.
Back for Sando, and he hits Rob, and the big man is over the line.
Panthers in-form fullback Matt Moylan left the game in the first half with a suspected ankle injury.
Ankle feeling around about the fibula, the outside bone in the ankle.
In Saturday afternoon football, the Rabbitohs were too good for the Gold Coast Titans, coming away with a 22-16 victory. The Brisbane Broncos continued their brilliant form, defeating the Canberra Raiders 24-12. The match featured what could be the try of the year, scored by Lachlan Maranta.
The ball comes with Boyd, away to Hutt, he's down the sideline. Put on,
The North Queensland Cowboys are on a winning streak with yet another win, this time over the Manly Sea Eagles 18 points to 14. The New Zealand Warriors held on to defeat the Newcastle Knights 24 points to 20 in a thrilling match to keep their spot in the top 8. Sunday afternoon football saw the Dragons run havoc around the Sharks, thrashing them 42 points to 6. Benji Marshall was at his best with good support from Fijian winger Eto Nubuli. Dion Kombang, National, MTV Sports.
And that report wraps up our True Guy Sports segment tonight. Coming up next, the weather details for the next 24 hours.
True Guy Sports. True Guy Sports.
A quick look at the weather forecast for the next 24 hours in southern region. Brief evening showers expected in Port Moresby and Kerama. In Momase, few showers expected in Madang and Bunnymore. In the New Guinea Islands, showers plus thunderstorms expected in Loranga. And lastly, in the Islands region, all centres brief evening showers, then morning fog. A recap of our top stories again tonight. Students protest over shortage of accommodation. Also, Baki's proposal to split regional police commands and progress in the prevention of maternal mortality. Well, that's been the news, sports and weather tonight from the news team. I'm Tokana Hasavi. Thanks heaps for your company. You have a pleasant working week. Good night.